open source. It started in the world of software and has evolved to physical objects, from furniture to drones. Their blueprints are now shared openly. Open source means that you share your knowledge and files and provide everyone the rights to make, change, and distribute these designs. And access to these resources empowers people to learn, solve problems, and start businesses. As founder of a platform where communities develop open source hardware, I've seen this movement grow from a handful of geeks to a very important pivotal point where it's starting to impact millions of people. Let me show you how. 2 months ago, a startup company in Japan called Axie did something that goes straight against the business textbooks. Axie had developed a myoelectric prosthesis. That's a prosthetic arm that you control with the electronic pulses present in your muscles. Now, Axie knew that their sophisticated product was too expensive for a large group of people in this world. So they developed a simplified version that could be 3D printed. They called it Hackberry and made it open source. When Axie shared the blueprints of their design on the Wevolver web platform, our team member Cameron got excited about the project and started posting about it on social media. The project struck a nerve. Within a week, millions of people had seen it. And among them was Matt Cashman. His brother Ryan had recently lost both of his hands in a work accident. And Ryan was in need of a specialized prosthetic. So now that the large community had gotten involved, Matt Cashman could leverage their collaborative skills and get his brother the prosthesis that he needed. Soon a team of from over 40 individuals spread it all across the globe, started to innovate on the Hackberry. They come from various kinds of backgrounds. They make any R&D department jealous. For example, there's Max, a young gifted engineer who's soon heading to a top university. But he's now in a summer job, so contributing to the Hackberry project enables him to keep growing his skills. There's a company that jumped in by making 3D scans of Ryan's arms, and another one is manufacturing parts out of solid aluminum. And among the team there's Neela, and Neela is a hand surgeon who works in the team that did the first hand transplant in Australia. Now Neela had never done any making, any engineering before. She's never touched a 3D printer. But now her expertise is incredibly valuable to the designers in the team. So we have one of the prototypes here. It's fully 3D printed. It uses affordable off-the-shelf electronics. And this is then the sensor that picks up the electronic signals present in your muscles. And it's already a beautiful piece of engineering, I think. It's a very powerful idea that, as we speak, people are innovating this design and making it stronger and better. And not only will Ryan get the prosthesis that he needs, but also the knowledge that this team has been accumulating, it remains available for others to build upon and keep making better and better and stronger prosthesis. So the high level of contributions, as well as the diversity of the background of these team members, it's reflecting a development I've seen in open hardware, where projects are moving out of the hands of purely engineering to a broad range of people and also nonprofits and businesses, and their efforts, they're starting to merge. And that is strongly empowering people to make new technologies. So anyone with an internet connection can now tap into this. A project from a charity called Tech for Trade is showing the impact that this makes. Tech for Trade shared a remarkable technology on Wevolver. It's software that enables you to build 3D printers out of electronic waste. So tell the program that you have a leftover fax machine, and it shows you how to make a 3D printer from that. And that enables you to build super low-cost 3D printers. And the major problem with using 3D printers in developing areas is costs, not only for purchasing machines, but also for getting specialized parts that you need, for example, to keep the machines running during maintenance. Things like power supplies, they all need to be imported from other countries, and that often triples their costs. So thanks to this software, 3D printers can now be locally built and maintained by their owners. This enabled Roy Ombati to start a 3D printing business in Kenya. Roy didn't need large upfront capital. He could start building a batch of 3D printers and get his business off the ground. He's also in the power to keep his machines running if things didn't break down. And if technology evolves, Roy can keep evolving his printers as well. And though it's nothing new that people in developing areas are sharing and collaborating openly, now these makers are connected to a global network, strongly empowering them to use technology. Within this network, we find another company, OpenRV from California, and they show how projects can move from passionate individuals to thriving businesses. So OpenRV develops underwater robots for exploration, used by amateurs, scientists, and companies alike to explore lakes and oceans, and shipwrecks, and then send images and data back to the surface. Interestingly, OpenRV would have not existed at all if it weren't open source. The company's founders, Eric Stackpole and David Lang, were both engineers and makers, but to develop their first underwater robot, they needed to learn new skills. They started sharing their ideas on a forum and steadily grew this community of co-developers around their work. And besides effectively crowdsourcing engineering, people started to request if they could buy a robot. And then Eric and David held a crowdfunding campaign, raised over $1 million, and a company was formed. In return for you sharing your knowledge, your community provides you users, potential customers, and an R&D department. And in the case of OpenRV, that's over 4,000 people spread across 50 countries. Most of them amateur scientists, but also top engineers, and even National Geographic got involved when they made a dive with the robot into underwater caves in Mexico. This diverse community has enabled OpenRV to become the largest manufacturer of underwater robots in the world. And following the development of their robots from up close, you see that when a community is able to enhance your product, it's in continuous development. And then the more diverse backgrounds and the more people you can attract to your community, the greater potential skills that you have access to and the better your product can become. We are at a tipping point. More and more people start to leverage this power. And that's reflected in the quality of the technologies that they are evolving and also in the scope, the types of products that people are making. And seeing what our users are building is extremely inspiring because you guys are also able to build bikes using 3D printers or work on an exoskeleton that's helping athletes train for the Paralympics. There is PLEN, a 3D printable robot that will teach you about robotics, 3D printing, and software engineering. OS Vehicle, a company that designs a base for electronic cars that empowers independent producers to change the car industry. And if you're into space photography, there's Ultrascope. It's a telescope that's smartphone controlled and automatically points towards planets, galaxies, and asteroids. So even the technology to contribute to space exploration is now within the hands of everyone. And this body of resources, these projects, it just keeps growing and growing. So think what Wikipedia did by opening up knowledge and realize that the power to create technology is now available. And that empowers you to learn, to solve problems, and start your businesses. From 3D printed prosthetics, drones that explore the deep ocean, or telescopes that map space. These innovators, increasingly coming from all different backgrounds, are changing science, economics, and our education. Welcome to the democratization of technology. Thank you.